My name is Abhishek Joshi, and on behalf of LHRDN, a very warm welcome to all of you. Our country has seen a revolution in the last decade, the digital revolution. This revolution has changed the way we live, we work, and we interact with other people. This revolution has also impacted the economy and society at large. As businesses and HR professionals, it is important for us to understand how has this revolution changed and impact the employees and the way the businesses operate and engage with their employees. And to discuss on this today, we have amongst us Mr. Yashish Dahiya, CEO and co-founder, PolicyBazaar.com, Mr. Irfan Abdullah, Director, Talent Solutions, LinkedIn India, Mr. Kashyap Vadapalli, CMO and Business Head, Pepperfry.com, and Mr. Sai Sati Sadagopan, Head Digital Business, TCS. We also have with us Ms. Imrana Sheikh, Vice President and Head HR Asian Paints, who will be moderating the session for all of us. So let's give a big round of applause for all of you. Can I now meet President NHRDN and Chief HR of ICICI Prudential Life Insurance to give his to set the context for the session. Sujit, if you can.
Just for the benefit of the audience, because we went through the introductions probably a bit faster, I think we just go through it one more time so that you can have a quick read of it. I think, Yashish, thank you so much for being here. Really, really appreciate it. If you don't mind, let's go through all this with you. And fantastic startup, so congratulations for funding. Irfan from LinkedIn. So, if you look at the choice of panelists here, you'll find Yashish from office in the e-commerce world, and Irfan is from the social media world. So, the idea was to get people from diverse backgrounds, so you get plurality of perspective in terms of how people approach the digital revolution and talk a bit more about that. You also have Kashyap Vadapalli. He's currently with Pepperfry, and before that he was with eBay and extensive experience in also the e-learning space with Tata Interactive and for that with Cadbury's. So get different viewpoints of people from different sectors so that we get the plurality of perspective, because the important thing is looking at the end of the day, how to bring in diversity to make sure that we are learning from all the different experiences of people from different backgrounds. And of course, TCS, market leader in terms of India's most valuable company. Pleasure to have you, Sai, with us. I head for digital business for TCS, and that covers everything, right? And I asked him, does it cover Smack? All of you would know Smack, right? Social media, mobile, cloud, and analytics. He said, no, it's a new trend's coming. So we don't want to call it Smack, it's digital. And I'm sure he'll talk more about it. And of course, Imrana, thank you so much for moderating the session. Very own Imrana Sheikh. Please give them a big hand. So we have a full house. I'm delighted with that. Thank you very much, audience. But I think what will delight us more is when you engage the participants in very difficult questions. So I'm priming you up for this, right? So please do push the panelists to challenge them, because it's the whole thing is about having contrarian perspectives. And the whole idea of getting a diverse set of panelists here with the kind of evidence they have is to make sure that we benefit a lot out of their wisdom and their insight. And the important thing is, what do we carry back to the workplace with us? Because yes, the fact of the matter is digital revolution is happening. Fact of the matter is scope and scale of technology have changed enormously. It's going to impact us both in economic terms and in social terms. The way we are working, the way we lead our lives, the way we buy, the way we interact with each other is changing. What does it mean, therefore, for the future of work and for the future of workplaces, right? And as HR professionals, since largely most of us are in the HR fraternity, the important thing is, what does it mean in terms of managing change and transformation, right? Because at the end of the day, how do we surface issues? Because there's a lot of anxiety about all this, right? There's a lot of anxiety. How do we contain that? How do we get people to adopt new behaviors, right? How do we amplify this? How do we support people in this change? How do we ensure that we are lubricating the wheels of resistance that are there, which sometimes caused by fear, sometimes caused by uncertainty? There's a huge role that HR can do in terms of effective change management. And that's the central role that HR has, especially in the context of fast and changing world. Change is not new. But I think the point is, we are making the speed and acceleration of change is something that we need to be worried about, because at the end of the day, yes, human ingenuity and imagination has made sure that over centuries we have been able to adapt to change. But there are people who don't adapt, and there is inertia of habit. So how do we deal with all this is something we want to make it reflective for all of us. We want to challenge, we want to make it confident. So we would request you again to put your questions before the panel. We have stellar cast here, and I'm looking forward to a very invigorating session. So thank you very much, all of you, and looking forward to a great session. Thank you.
Can I now request Ms. Ibrana to welcome the judges on the, to the panelists on stage? So let's welcome them with a big round of applause.
So can we, before we begin, can we have a show of hands of people who believe that through digital revolution, the connections are multiplying? Almost everybody. And how many of you all believe that with digital revolution, conversations are dying? So about, what's the percentage you think? 40-45%. Okay, so that's the kind of dichotomy that we are living in this era, and we definitely want to kind of have a lot of examples, have a lot of perspectives, and for a change, not from people who belong to the HR fraternity. And we always get accused as HR fraternity that we do not listen to business enough. And here's a brilliant opportunity to us to first of all talk about a topic that's being talked about throughout the world. And at the same time, hearing it not from the HR friends, but hearing it from our business friends. So thank you so much for joining us. And so to begin with, let's just try to decode this word, digital revolution, because we've heard about agricultural revolution, which moved us from hunting to farming. We have heard about the industrial revolution, which took 100 years to get mechanization to a level that we could remember. And now we are in the era of digital revolution. So let's just decodify this a little bit, and maybe I could request Sai to talk about what does digital revolution mean to you, and how is it really impacting the economy?
Can you hear me? Two words this whole digital revolution could be personally, right? One is exciting, second is scary. Exciting from a perspective of technology. Never ever we had so many things coming at us, thrown at us together at the same time. Right? If you look at gradually each of the revolutions that we had, it was always with a certain set of people, right, which was much more specialized and impacted that, and which caused that started to explode and change the behavior of the entire country or nation or any of these things, right? But today, we have certain things that are thrown at us which fundamentally changes the way we behave, right? For generations and centuries, never has the redefinition of a word called friend, right? Today, a definition of friend is all about, you know, how are you, you know, a friend on Facebook, it's not something that's so big up, right? The definition of friend for us has completely changed in terms of what we do. So, a technology that is thrown at us has fundamentally changed our social behavior in terms of how we interact. It has affected everybody, right? It's never to a certain sect, to irrespective of whatever sex or whatever the sect, it's completely everybody is kind of affected. Scary to the point that this overuse of technology has resulted in exposing us to a certain set of information which has completely become boundaries, right? So, now today we always, when we share information, it was always about family, extended family, goes on, right? Now there are no more things. Now we are all of these concentric circles which are kind of interlinked, which goes on, our information now keeps kind of spreading around, right? So it's scary to the point that today what we are talking about is being read by somebody whom we have no connection to, right? Because he's a friend of a friend and a friend is keeps on doing, so the fact that the information spreads and people know about you and they're able to relate to you, this is the where the scariest portion comes. The best part of it is today, people communicate, right? So earlier we had a challenge of people, voicing in our country, in the sense that it always has to be somebody, it's always used to be one single leader speaks and everybody hangs behind them, right? Today there is an opportunity for everybody to voice their opinion, right? Whether to make fun or make a viewpoint or whatever it is from that perspective. Today they want to be heard of, right? And the fact that the digital world gives them the identity, while it identifies who's speaking about what and what point you're making, but the fact it is, it's known to the entire world and people are feeling proud of it. I have a viewpoint on everything that is happening. And that is great from today's right? That's changed the behavior, right? We're not talking about a one single leader talking and everybody talking to it. It's all about more of collective wisdom that everybody is talking. Then you look at the sentiment analysis and say, yes, everybody is talking, whether it makes sense or not, but there is always a kind of orientation towards collective wisdom. Third is the amount of data or information that's getting generated because of that. So because of this, you are able to really understand the behavior, both right, in terms of the consumption behavior or the social behavior, all the viewpoint we have. So everything is now collected as information which will be dissected in multiple number of ways to really pinpoint about what is the characteristics of a particular person, right? So if somebody has to look into a series of tweets and your postings, they will be able to come back and tell you what are your likes. What do you like? Much better than your wife, probably they will know about it. Right? That's the generation that we are kind of living with. So exciting because you're getting a lot of new technology, right? So never before we had a lot of this technology that we thought as now we had. When we went through radio, then television, then suddenly internet, and after the internet, suddenly we have the mobile. Now everything else, social, everything has been thrown at us. So it's exciting from that perspective. There are new things that are coming about. As I said, scary because we don't know where it is leading to.
Thank you, Sai. Taking a cue from the word exciting and scary, is this descriptors given by two different sets of generations, or is the statements that we hear that youth is adopting technology or digital space very fast, but the earlier generations find it frightening? So is it more exciting for the youth and is it more scaring for the earlier generation? Is this still true or this is something which describes the past and no more a reality? So Irfan, if I can request you.
Can you all hear me? Okay. It's great. So it's great to be here. And in fact, we're talking about digital revolution in an audience wherein I see a lot of students and young professionals. And I think they are at the forefront of this revolution. Similar to what Sai was saying, before I specifically answer your question, I think what you have to understand is what has happened with the digital revolution is it's shortened the cycle when it comes to economic transition. Right? Earlier, what was a transition of centuries, think about agrarian to industrial economy, right? Which then transitioned to, I would say, decades, right? Which is industrial to information. Now it's kind of happening in maybe a couple of years, and we have actually people in the panel who are actually in that kind of industry. So I think the entire shift is actually being phenomenal. And pace, and I would say the way in which productivity is actually a big part of it. And if you kind of think about two stats which I can answer, which possibly gives an answer to the question. If you look at our country, in India, almost 60 to 65% of the population is under 30. I don't know, a lot of people know this, but India is the second largest smartphone market in the world. I'm not talking about the phone market, it's the second largest smartphone market in the world. So clearly, the reason I'm bringing that startup and that's relevant to your question is, if you think from either if you're in a B2B segment or B2C segment, be it your consumers, are actually like, you've got a huge population in the segment. Be it your customers, they're actually in the segment. So clearly, it's not a choice. You have to sort of figure out a way to sort of engage with this population. And one of the interesting things that we kind of see is increasingly, we kind of read this quite a lot, adaptability is a very important thing. And if you look at like today, some of the greatest leaders, the terms that they always frequently talk about is like transparency, humility, adaptability, right? And the reason I'm bringing that up again is if you think about learnability, and it's a big factor in this. So a lot of companies today kind of talk about the concept of reverse mentoring, right? Which is, and this are actually like very well-known companies like Unilever, or actually even new age companies like us. Because you can always learn, like the best input that I get from the business is not necessarily from my manager or my leader, it's actually someone from the ground. So I think the point is, if you really need to understand your consumer, if you need to understand your customer, you need to have voice from the ground, right? And that's why I think reverse mentoring is one example of that. And increasingly what we see is like going back to adaptability and humility, because I think as leaders, unless you are humble enough to say that, right, there is always someone else who can actually give a better answer, you can never improve. If you look at one of the interesting stats is very few companies today which is in the top Fortune 100 would be actually even existing maybe 20, 30 years back. So it's all about adaptability and how you can actually innovate. Otherwise, you can't really sort of prosper. So that's what I would say when it comes to it.
Thank you so much, Irfan. Now, to build on the scary piece a little bit, I think one of the things, Yashish, that's also worrying the organizations or the economy or the society is the kind of risks that are getting linked with this digital revolution. Risks in the form of the fact that even babies are spending time on iPads and iPhones and are more very comfortable. So is it lowering the social intelligence in the society? And is it creating risk like data privacy, social bullying? I mean, are there risks that you see that is getting created in the social, in the digital space?
First of all, certainly, there are those risks, and you kind of read about them quite a bit. But, you know, specifically when you're looking at from an organizational perspective, I think one of the things that's happening in the organization is the layers are breaking down very, very rapidly. And I would even go to the extent of saying that some of the new age companies, if you are not interacting directly, at least on social basis, with the CEO quite regularly, you're kind of out of the loop of the organization because the entire thinking started concentrating there. Now that has obviously got reverse impacts to it. Just to put some perspective to this. So somebody, we got a mail a couple of days back, right? It was from one organization which wrote this particular mail. And this is a group of friends, and the distance between employees, and I get this a lot from my HR, that one day, you know, I could end up in trouble. The difference between employees and friends has just closed out. And so I straight away responded to that mail saying something quite stupid. Like I said, you know, these guys usually don't write these mails, somebody's taking their money, something of that sort, right? Now the point is, if one of these employees actually leaves our organization tomorrow, which is possible, or sends it into social media, or even sends it, God forbid, to that organization, they would have a very bad opinion of it. And not just to, like, it could look quite bad. But at the end of it, it was a very casual. The point is, information from the organization is out, and it can be taken totally out of context. And I think that is a genuine fear, which at least I get told off by our HR quite a bit about. It doesn't stop me from interacting. I'm like, okay, somebody wants to put it out there. I think that's one piece. Data privacy is another one. We, of course, I'll see you when I'm giving examples of what our organization can see how they reflect. We, of course, have a lot of consumer data coming in, right? We have 180 people at ID. We all have access to this data. This data is worth at least 30, 40 lakh rupees every day. They could just sell it out. If they wish. There's no company in this world that can kind of say that nobody in their IT has access to their data. Like, you know, I'll be very surprised if somebody can say that. That will also be scary. So the point is, and with the mechanisms available, that and this is at a point where we don't even allow somebody to see a phone. So you know, there's lots of risk. There is, of course, the other side of it. So we had one particular company, I won't name them, large media organization, which started targeting our employees, right? So, and they had everybody's list because it's very simple, you know, it's so simple to target. So there are risks out there. But I'm not so fussed about those. There are a lot more opportunities from all of this. I think the fact that layers are broken down and we communicate like friends, at least to a level of three. So in my view, in our organization, if somebody is not connected with me, which is kind of the think tank of our organization, then I really am struggling to figure out what they're doing. Because that means, it's not like we have one strategy plan and everybody's doing their thing, and you know, once in a month we'll kind of send a mail that, okay, my stuff is done. Everybody's on kind of the same, you know, platform, and usually we are communicating with a WhatsApp, or so most of our conversations on WhatsApp is kind of stopped. And so clearly the options are far stronger. Imagine the power of that, where about 100 people going all the way from manager to CEO, and within the IT and everything. Everybody's there. I'll give you one example of this. Today we just won a case where one of our domain names, Online Policy Bazaar, we just got that back. This is a legal case, right? So legal rights back that, okay, we've got that domain back. It straight away goes to our online marketing people who say, okay, that means we can use this for SEO purposes, because of course it was having an impact on our SEO. Our paid search guys, we've got one competitor bidding very heavily on our own keyword. So we say, okay, that means we can compete. Now, all of this is happening within a span of like 5-10 minutes. Imagine how this would be feasible some time back, where legal department and marketing would not even speak to each other. This is an example from today morning. And most probably, it would have started bidding by kind of tomorrow morning. And in this, you know, it's also got structured. So there's a lot that happens very, very rapidly, you know, at least in a growing organization.
Thank you so much. I know, and like you rightly said, the world has come closer in this digital revolution. But there's another angle to this. While the world has come closer, the technology infrastructure is not the same everywhere. And what it has meant to India is that India has almost got divided into two. One where the technology infrastructure is very superior, and one where the technology infrastructure is not that superior. Now, what does it translate, Kashyap, in terms of business strategies? Do you really need to have different business strategies to kind of address this?
It's an interesting question. You know, some days ago we were speaking to a bunch of people who were interested in evaluating our company, and for every opportunity or every initiative that we talked about, they kept saying, okay, so what's the mobile strategy on this? Okay, what is your mobile first approach on this? So, you know, then we started talking about what really is the technology infrastructure. We said, okay, there are 300 million people on the internet in India today. 150 million of them, half of them, supposedly access the internet only via the mobile phone. The other 150 have kind of a mixed access. They access it on the desktop and on the mobile phone. And within that, also increasing proliferation of smartphones means that the percentage of time that they're on the internet, even the first 150, it's increasing on the mobile and not so much on the desktop. So what's happening is different sets of customers are getting created. This is especially true for an online-led company like ours, where, you know, all of our transactions, our interactions with the consumers, etc., happens online. So we're talking about a bunch of people who access us only through the mobile. We're talking about a bunch of people who have access via desktop and mobile, and therefore the way we speak to them, how we speak to them, needs to kind of fit the form factor that we're talking about. Also, you know, when you think of this deeply, it's not just about the form factor. It's actually about the type of consumer. The type of consumers who are accessing internet on the mobile phone only, okay, with very limited desktop access, are probably people below a certain income strata, or people who below a certain age strata, and people who are more or less on the go, etc. So what that means is that, you know, that when you're talking to somebody who is primarily a mobile only access consumer, you already know a little bit about them in terms of what their income is, what age they are. So let's say if I was selling fashion, let's say t-shirts worth 400 bucks or shoes worth 750 bucks, and I'm selling primarily to college and high school students and younger working professionals, then you know it's a great thing. I mean, for example, I have a mobile first approach and I target them and I reach a very large number of people. But when I'm selling furniture, and you know, which is the case with Pepperfry, Pepperfry sells furniture online, mostly furniture online, and you know, the ticket size is 15,000 rupees. The kind of people who are buying this are, the average age is 35. This is usually a joint decision between husband and wife. We've done enough research to find that. Most of our purchases happen after 9 in the night and on the weekends. So the consumer behavior is very, very different. So yes, you know, and for these people, when it's a joint decision, there's a discussion, ability to share images, ability to evaluate stuff together, etc. You know, the way they interact with technology is very different. So obviously, when we are looking at providing solutions, targeting consumers with specific types of products, we are obviously looking at what is the technology that they're most likely going to be using, where can we get the best kind of conversions, where can we give them the best information that we can. So I think, yes, as in India today, there are a certain bunch of people who have access to all technology. There are certain people who have access to limited technology, and then there are a vast majority who are still not on the internet. For us, for example, we're not serving them currently. Okay, and if we were to serve them, I think we need to develop a whole set of new algorithms to reach them and, fulfill the requirements. So I think yes, keeping track of how technology is getting used by consumers is very, very important for not only the kind of technology that we use with the backend to target them, but also the organizational culture in terms of the kind of people we are hiring, in terms of their mindset and how are we developing the skill sets that they require. Because that they need to match with the different sets of consumers that are out there. So I think it's important with changing technology to bring in a workforce that understands how technology is being used by consumers, so that they're able to develop those skill sets for the right kind of targeting and messaging.
Thank you, Kashyap. And so far, I think what we have done with our eminent panelist here is actually looked at a lot of socio-cultural and economic factors. And just want to kind of shift the lens right now, because we are here in majority HR people, and we all are grappling with some challenges, and we want to kind of understand how digital revolution is going to be impacting it in future, as well as how we can probably address some of our current issues. So I'm going to shift the lens right now and move into talking a few softer topics and see your perspective as business leaders and what it means to you. And like you have been doing, more examples you share, the more alive the perspective becomes to us. So please continue doing that. So one of the first questions, I think I'm borrowing the word smack that Jeet spoke about, and we've been hearing it all around. So how is smack going to change the workplace for tomorrow? It's already changed a lot, but I think the end is not here. We still have a lot more change to see. So anyone from the panelists can answer this question, but maybe, Sai, you want to start? Yeah.
So we at TCS, being an IT services company, right, we deal with a lot of knowledge workers, right? When we have a bunch of technologies, right, so there's no way we could keep them away from emerging technologies, right? So we had an era when chats became very popular, right? You have now chats, now Google, right? So which became disruptive at work, and almost all every company started to block them, saying they're being not disruptive work, because they were using the office infrastructure to kind of now when you come into this old smack, right? So when you have personal devices being come into the office where all of these are being open, right? There is no way an organization can actually restrict some of these things. I can't say you can't do on WhatsApp, right? So one of the things what we have realized is that given that now we have more than 3 lakh employees across 3 or 4 generations, having been the largest and oldest IT company here, we have 3 or 4 generations within our company. Right? We realized about 5 years back that the amount of youngsters that are coming into the corp have a completely different mindset, and we are here to block their freedom. Right? That's the first thing that we realized. No,
because we are dealing with a workforce that is completely different from the way we kind of grew up. So we started to look, you know, inside ourselves to see what would such a workforce in the smart world, what would they need to do translate into the workplace. So we started creating a certain set of environments within our organization that will bring them to the forefront. So for example, the traditional way of having an internet, right, where somebody logs in, looks at how organization is classified or push only information, we moved to a completely different concept where we created collaboration. Right? Because today it is no more an organization coming and saying, here's my policy. Right? Today we have to create a collaboration where a policy is put out, people debate on it, and we look at from the overall perspective of what people are talking about, look at what we need to adopt and we need to change. There are a lot of examples within our company where we have changed policies because of the way employees have spoken, right? So SMAC has given us the capability to ensure that the freedom of speech is there, right? We are not trying to restrict them saying that don't interact with your friends, but we are trying to make it, how you bring it into the workplace, what we call as a workplace reimagination, right? So we are saying collaboration is not only with respect to chats that you deal with friends. You can also do chats within the office where you can exchange information of knowledge that can be adapted. And it has been very successful for us because what we have done is basically we brought the outside tools inside the organization so that an organization can actually improve on it. And it has been pretty successful because of the fact that we are dealing with the knowledge work, we don't need to teach them. So we moved away from, we have a lot of virtual town halls, people interacting like this. We kind of, transcended the barriers that we have in an organization of reaching out to somebody, because I can always reach out and post a question to anybody and digitally they will be willing to answer rather than calling up somebody, right? So we've broken the communication barriers, created an atmosphere that actually enables a quite a bit of collaboration.
Thanks a lot, Sai. So another question that is regularly coming in my head is in terms of how is this going to impact structures? I mean, is there going to be any structural impact that we are going to see because of this digital revolution? Do you want to put that?
Sure. So, 7-8 years ago when I was working at, let's say, EcoCurse, which was also an online company, and now also I work in an online company, we didn't have structure. We were able to maintain structures. We didn't have, of course, the CEO, CMO, technology officer. Within them also, they had different mechanisms. We still have those. But what's happened, because of the changing pace of competition, because of the changing pace of innovation that is happening in the marketplace, you have to constantly think. And this is just a genuine phenomenon. It seems so odd because today I might be the CEO and tomorrow I might be some other role. But the entire organization has to stay connected because things change at a pace. And everybody needs to sort of move very rapidly to those. And when I say everybody, I mean, not just marketing and technology, which is pretty obvious, or product, but even things like legal or things like HR, they need to kind of stay connected on that. So what we realized is, and also our plans keep changing. So what do we want to do? I look at our technology plans. 3 months is perhaps the maximum you can hold it for. Beyond, it's very difficult to plan what you're going to do 6 months from now, 9 months from now, because somebody would have disrupted so massively that, you have that kind of a pace, and it's getting shorter. So what that implies, and I'm hearing this from a lot of at least early stage, or I won't say early stage, because these organizations which are about 500-600 people, that everybody is eventually connected all the way to the CEO, which is crazy, right? Because the CEO, you can't have a span of control of 100 people. Your span of control is at most 5, 6, 7, 8 people. And at the same time, if you have 5, 6, 7, 8 people, it's going to start becoming dysfunctional. You have to be able to, so people have to have the ability of breaking barriers and going through to somebody else all the way, talking to them, having influence. They're not thinking about who do I report to and why should I do this and why should I not do this. And those are throwing up challenges. So I think structures, clearly, the black thing is happening. Even how technology mixes with marketing, how marketing mixes with legal, all that stuff is going away because the pace that things have been moved at is so quick that they can't send an email to and expect a response to it. So I think those things are just moving at a much quicker pace, and that means structures are breaking down.
Now, when you specifically look at how HR needs to adapt to this, or how do you do planning for how do you do promotions, how do you do so? We struggled because at the end of the year, when you're trying to assess people on what they have done or who should assess them, we realized very quickly that just their manager was not adequate, and just their manager you could put a very elaborate process. I'm sure somebody very organized can do that. We had to run a business and compete with competition. Our primary task was not to organize a system to rate our people. That was not the business we were in. So we came up with this concept of heat maps. So heat maps are basically, it's nothing. It's just random feedback. Random feedback on anyone. Because we realized, the random feedback about our organization outside in the world is pretty true. And so the random feedback about anybody within the organization is pretty true. It's not what their manager thinks of them or what their... So that again is breaking down structures. Because everybody has a view on everybody. And that view on the whole is pretty true. And decisions get made on that, feedback happens on that. And people interact on that. Now the worst part or the best part of this is that feedback is available for everybody to see. So that's something we get from HR quite a bit. A lot of times is pushback. That look, you cannot have negative feedback or positive feedback so blatantly available about everybody in the organization. But it is actually blatantly available. So because pretty much everybody has the same feedback about the same individual. And so, individuals kind of decide very quickly whether they are in the organization or not in the organization. Can they change fast enough or can they not change? They really don't have to wait for that, after 3 months meeting with the boss and him saying, oh, we are doing well or not doing well. Those changes are happening. I still see the massive positive out of it. The massive positive is the entire organization is aligned. They don't have to second guess. There are no real layers. People are able to be connected and know what they're supposed to do and kind of be responsible for that, do it, inform everybody that's done, collaborate. So that's what's going on. And the more it's gonna get a lot stronger. And I think there's this massive space for organizations to come in, like what LinkedIn is doing and some other organizations doing. There will be organizations that come into managing space of this for HR as well, people who are more data centric.
Thank you. So maybe a question to Irfan. Is it fair to accuse the digital revolution to be causing the attrition concerns? And is it also fair to blame digital revolution for the belief that 55% of the people in this room have that conversations are dying? So is it creating an impact on employee communication? Are conversations within organizations reducing because of digital revolution?
Interesting question. I heard from a wise man that I can actually try to stop the people from leaving, or I have a choice of giving the reasons to stay. Okay. And I think as a HR professional, the reality is that it's such a 24/7 world today. Right? Like the information is there publicly. You have a choice of trying to sort of say that, okay, let me try to sort of do ring fencing. Right? Like for example, a lot of traditional companies have this concept, okay, there's like a period till which you train and you can't leave the company. But it's almost like, if you kind of think about it in a company like us, it's almost like bonded labor. Right? Because that's not, ultimately, and our founder Reid Hoffman, who is one of the most well-known thinkers in the world, he's actually invested in a company like Facebook, he's a startup LinkedIn, and look at all this, he kind of talked about this concept of what I would call tour of duty. The interesting thing in LinkedIn, what we kind of talked about is like our hope, right? When we actually get a person on board, is like our hope and belief is actually you will be there throughout your life in LinkedIn. But we realize it may not be there. It may be possible that tomorrow you want to start your own team company. It may actually happen that you may actually get a career transformation opportunity which is even bigger than what you are doing in LinkedIn. But our promise is actually when you leave there, when you leave, whatever time you decide to leave, you will be a completely changing group. When you look at a career trajectory, it will be a completely different level. And I think that's something as HR professionals is important for people to engage. And there's a concept of tour of duty wherein you kind of think about how do I actually ensure that I actually give that exposure to talent, right? Because if I don't give that exposure to talent, you have other companies who will do that, right? And today, the interesting thing is like, I don't think age is anymore a barrier. I don't think even skill set is another barrier, because a lot of times people are acting in some of the industries that they were working in. It's all very new age, right? A lot of people are doing their job, it's possibly the biggest job that they've ever done in their life. They are actually doing things which has never happened. So what you just need to do is actually be very adaptable and actually need to sort of really learn fast. And that's why I think from an HR perspective, what you need to understand is actually this entire concept that how do you ensure that engagement is something which is very strong, right? Because ultimately, if your engagement is strong, your retention will be high. Right? And if you're careful saying that, you know what, like, okay, what I'll possibly sign like a no poach with my competitor or other, it's beyond a point not scalable, right? Because if you kind of think about the decision to leave the company, and we kind of do exit interviews with you, and you are in a profession, I'm sure you possibly know this better. The decision to leave the company is not decided when actually the person is putting the resignation. It's actually something which happens much before. So when you are actually like having that phase, almost like 2 to 3 months has possibly happened, and then you are actually starting to understand how do I regain actually. And I think there are companies who try to do that actually. So the point is, you need to figure out a way to sort of make it the workplace, the dream workplace, right? You need to actually challenge the body called the of beauty, and it could mean different to different people. It could be new skills, it could be a new function, it could be a manager responsibility. But it's not a one-size-fits-all approach. You need to figure out what really appeals to you.
And on the conversations dying within the work environment, do you believe so? Are you amongst the 45% or amongst about 55%?
I think that's not happening. I think Jesh is briefly touched upon that, and I'm sure we'll talk about cultural and the importance of communication, right? Because I had this interesting conversation with HR head of one of the leading large IT majors in India, and they actually, like a few years back, said that actually, let's kind of have social media guidelines. Let's figure out a way actually to sort of ensure that employees don't post about it. And obviously, smart Indians, we actually figured out loopholes, right, to sort of get all kind of loopholes to sort of do that. And I think in like almost like 1 or 2 months time frame, they realized that actually they're not doing one thing, which is most important, which is they're not trusting their employees. Because when we hire them, we are trusting them to do their job well. When we hire them, actually, and I think you were talking about IDs, like having all information. You're trusting a lot of information, right? So I have a choice of actually sort of always like questioning there and saying, okay, well, you're doing everything right. Or I actually go with the choice of like, I trust them. I need to verify, but I trust them actually. And I think that's where I would say from a communication, you beyond a point can't stop, right? And you see a lot of B2C companies today, right? Where it, like the CEOs actually are acting like, I think it's very easy. I'm actually not happy with my credit card. Today, the fastest way to get a response that I believe is actually, okay, you go to the Twitter handle and actually put something and the CEO sort of respond. And that's real. And I think one of the interesting things our CEO, Jeff Weiner, recently did is like, he put a post saying that, okay, if there is one thing that you want to change on LinkedIn, what it would be. And he got almost like 20,000 comments. 20,000 comments he got, right? So what do? We kind of try to figure out, okay, what is actually the common trend and all that, right? Because you have so much of information, right? And so I think I would say, instead of saying that it's actually a barrier, figure out a way how you can harness that information and sort of make your company better and make your work better.
Thanks, Irfan, for sharing that perspective. And I think I couldn't stop myself from asking this question to you, Yashish. Basically, one of the questions that has been, again and again, when I think about Pepperfry, the speed at which the brand has grown, and I think it's commonly known, and you're right, there are many, not surprising that a lot of people in the youth are using Pepperfry, because it was one of my young cousins who introduced me to the brand. But just a question that's kind of coming into my mind is that, are organizations doing adequate in the space of employer branding, like they are investing in consumer brand in the digital world?
That's an interesting question. You know, when we were discussing the various aspects of, you know, what is true for employees in this age of digital, you know, the thing that kept going through my head is that for a consumer company like ours, really we are following what the consumer is doing. You know, we are trying to stay up to date with the consumer. And an organization's culture and ethos and everything is driven by the way the consumers behave. Okay, and we are trying to match that. What the employee culture and the internal culture of the organization also needs to kind of keep pace with that. Today, if the consumer is digital, and so let me just spend a couple of minutes on what I think is in very simple terms, what is digital? Digital today is One of the important points is balance of information. Okay. Earlier, it used to be all about control of information, testing with a few people, testing with, let's say, the CEO or the organization or the HR, and how they give information out to employees, or in the case of consumers, their information testing with marketing and advertising going out and consumers reacting to the advertising, whether good or bad, and forming their own opinion. So it was a lot about one-to-many communication that was going on, but now that's not the case. Now there is a lot of many-to-many conversation that is happening. Social media has enabled everybody to become an opinion leader, and therefore what it suddenly does is that consumers are not going to rely simply on what you're going to, just say. Consumers are going to rely on what you're going to say, what you're going to do, etc. I think the same thing becomes true for employees also. Okay. In terms of building out, let's say, the brand, I think people come in. We are a company that grew. We are now 500 people. 2 years ago, we were 200. Okay. So we've really grown fast. A lot of people have come. Some people have left. I think you can't really control, what people think and what people do. It's the opportunities that you provide, it is the culture that you are running, which will fundamentally determine, how employees start feeling about it. I think there are various tricks, etc., that we use in terms of, how we keep people when they come in, how our office looks, is there a lot of fun and games, and all of that stuff. But really, it boils down to the kind of work one is doing, whether they're growing in the work, whether there's opportunity for developing skills and stuff that Irfan spoke about in terms of upskilling and cross-skilling, etc. So I think our focus has really been on providing those opportunities to people as and when they come in. Because we are in the growth stage, we've been able to do that to people. So a lot of people who have joined us 2 years ago are doing different roles today. Their roles have either expanded or become more complicated or become more enriched. So I think we're really letting at this, and I think we're lucky, really, it's not a conscious decision. We're really riding the wave, so to speak, in terms of what's going on and how our employees are feeling about that. Just a couple of other quick points relating to the challenge, actually, and maybe this is not an answer to your question, but one of the things that I find is that speed of learning. We are not really finding ready-made talent out there to come in and fit these slots that, the organization has a certain ambition and it wants to grow in a certain way, and we realize that there are certain skill sets and certain roles that we need to kind of fill. And we're not really finding those people, whether it's technology, whether it's marketing, not finding people with enough experience, not finding people with enough competencies. And earlier, I don't think it was a problem. I worked in, old world economy, we did distribution, bike truck, etc., etc. I think the luxury that was there earlier was that people could come in and learn on the job and then become effective at it. And there were systems and structures which allowed that to happen. Now with all the structures collapsing, with everything being flat, and ready-made talent not being available, actually getting people in and expecting them to perform from day one, I think that's one of the biggest challenges that we're facing. And the reason for that, this is because the rate at which the consumers are moving, the rate at which technology is moving, our ambition needs to keep pace with it. I don't really know if employee competencies and employee learning agility keeps pace with that. And that, I think, is something that we are struggling with at the startup.
Thanks, Kashyap.